My name is Dina Katabi, and I'm a faculty here in Electrical Engineering and Computer Science. And I'll be talking about the future of mobile video, or the future of mobile video from my perspective. So some of you may be wondering how mobile video is related to healthcare. And the answer actually is fairly simple. An important part of future healthcare is telemedicine. And you would like that, in the case of emergency, you would like a medical technician to be able to take a video of the patient and in real time get that information to the doctor who might be in a hospital that is far away from where the accident or the patient that is requiring the help. Not only this, but as you are carrying the patient in the ambulance, also you would like to keep in contact with the doctor because in many cases, actually, you are carrying these patients for sometimes hours inside the ambulance until you reach the doctor. And in fact, today, there are medical devices that allow the medical professionals in real time to take these videos so that in emergency situation, and you can always connect the patient to the specialist anywhere, anytime, and provide the best healthcare system that is possible. So all of this is great, and all of that can be provided to us if we can get good, robust mobile video. But we all also know that the story behind mobile video is not just telemedicine. Mobile video is really the next killer app. And beyond telemedicine, we are all excited about getting all TV programs to our handheld devices and also obtain our live concert, live sporting events anywhere, anytime on our tablets or cell phones. So all of this is great. The future is going to have mobile video. Telemedicine requires mobile video. What is the problem? The problem, we all know it. In fact, we know that mobile video suffers from glitches and stalls. Anyone who tried to watch mobile video on their iPhone knows that very well. Okay, and so let's try to understand where this problem comes from. The problem comes from wireless channels. Wireless channels, by nature, are erroneous channels. And if you add mobility, the channel becomes very, very unpredictable. It adds unpredictable variation in channel quality. So just imagine broadcasting video from some wireless transmitter to a wireless receiver. The channel in the middle shows high variations over very short time periods. In fact, even if I don't move, even if I just move my hand this way, you can see such very high variation in channel quality. So why this is problematic? This is problematic because all of our current wireless technology cannot deal well with high variation of channel quality and cannot transmit a video that works well for all channel qualities, for all channel variations. And this is a known problem. In technical term, it's called the performance cliff of mobile video, or video in general, wireless video. And if you plot the video quality as a function of the channel quality, which is what we typically refer to as the channel SNR, you will find a cliff effect. That is, you're going to see that the graph, the video quality, shows a cliff graph. And if you improve the channel quality beyond that critical point, the video quality doesn't improve. It stays the same thing. It levels off. And if the channel quality goes below that point, the video becomes unwatchable. Just you cannot extract any useful information as a user from that video. So that what creates glitches and stalls, because whenever you fall off this cliff, because the channel quality varies, you fall off that cliff and you get a glitch or you get stall if the falling off stays too long. Now, some of you may say, oh, I heard that you can change the modulation, the coding, you can change the video codec, you can add perhaps error correcting code, all of that helps. So what is the story with that? So all of that is true. You can change all of these things, and all that you are going to get is a different cliff point. So for example, here's a different cliff, which comes from a different modulation and code rate, which is the state-of-the-art video codec, which is what we call MPEG-4, Part-10, or H.264. And I can even draw for you a variety of these cliff points for all the modulation and coding that comes with your Wi-Fi, for example. And you can pick the cliff that you like. So whatever coding and modulation you are going to pick, and also codec, you're going to get one of these cliff points. You can pick which one you like best, but you cannot. You always are limited into like one of these cliffs. You can jump between cliffs if you like, but that's it. Now, ideally, we would like this code. That is, we would like a video quality that does have a smooth degradation as the channel quality degrades. So it is very smooth. It doesn't fall off a cliff. Not only this, but it is the best for any channel quality. It is much better than these cliff graphs, and it is smooth. And if we can achieve this video quality, then we will have no glitches and no stalls, because there is no cliff to fall off to, falling off from the cliff. So the natural question to ask, how can we achieve this ideal? But before I can tell you how we can achieve this ideal, let me tell you why today's video suffers this cliff effect. So why does today's video suffer a cliff? Today's video has two components. There is the video codec, which compresses the video, and there is the error-correcting code, which protects your video as you transmit it over the erroneous wireless channel. Now, the problem is that both compression and error protection codes transform real-valued pixel luminance into just sequences of bits. And these sequences of bits destroy the numerical property of the original pixels. So, for example, if you have a sequence of bits like 1110 and 1111, which differ only in one bit, they might refer to pixel luminance that are completely different, 5 and 149. So there is no protection of what is the least significant bit and what is the most significant bit in the luminance values. And in practice, the situation is much worse than that, because all video codecs use something called Huffman code or entropy code. And if you have one residual bit error in that code, you can lose synchronization between the receiver and the transmitter. So you lose synchronization, and as a result, basically the receiver sits there, he doesn't know where the code words end, and he's just completely unable of decoding the video. Okay, so today we have a video system such that if the receiver can correctly decode all the video bits, then you get perfect video. You get this leveling. But if the receiver, after decoding, has one residual bit error, then you can get arbitrary errors in the received video. Okay? And this is why you get the cliff effect. Now, many of you maybe will remember a different style of video that didn't show a cliff effect. So can you guys guess what kind of the video that is? That didn't show this like stopping suddenly? Analog TV, yeah. Analog TV actually does not show a cliff effect. And of course, I'm not saying let's go back to analog TV. There is a very good reason that we moved away from analog TV to digital TV, because analog is completely inefficient. But analog got one thing right, which is that it didn't have a cliff effect. So let us try to learn from analog TV this one thing that it got right, while at the same time trying to avoid all the bad things of analog TV. Let's see whether we can do it. So if you look at analog TV did not suffer a cliff effect because analog TV did not take real number pixel luminance and transform them into bits. What it actually did, it took the real number pixels and scaled them up and down and transmitted them on the channel. So there was a linear relation between the signal that was transmitted on the channel and the pixel luminance inside the video. And that linear correspondence means that the least significant bit stays the least significant bit between the signal and the video, and therefore small errors that could disturb the transmitted signals translate naturally also to small errors in the received video. so you don't get a cliff effect. So this is the good about analog TV. The bad about analog TV is that it's inefficient. And it didn't compress the video. I mean, we all know video is highly compressible, so if you take a big video, you put it on the channel with all the redundancy in it without compression, you're not going to be efficient. So that's bad. Also, it didn't have really any mechanism for protecting the video from errors. So what we are going to do in the rest of this presentation, I'm going to present to you a system that we call Softcast, which combines the best of both worlds. Like digital video, it is efficient, but like analog TV, it has no cliff effect. So how can we do this? So this new system, Softcast, instead of dividing video transmission over wireless into two components, it actually has one component that both compresses the video and protects it from errors. So it has one joint code for compression and protection from errors. Now, the key property of this code is that it is linear. And because the code is linear, there is a linear relation between the signal samples and the pixel values. So when the signal samples, they are transmitted on the channel, and there is some noise that is affecting them, that noise translates, small noise translates also to small perturbation in the signal value. So the least significant bit when it is affected by noise translates into the least significant bit in the pixel luminance being affected by noise. You don't get a cliff effect. So are we happy with this? No, obviously, not yet. I just got you back analog TV. Okay? So this on itself is not good. The real challenge is to maintain this linear behavior while compressing the video and protecting it from errors. Okay. So this is exactly what we are going to do, to have this joint code but satisfy these two requirements.